very much for coming on this wonderful early summer's evening. My name is John Keane. I'm a professor of politics here at the University of Sydney, and I write a bit about democracy. I had a hand in the foundation of the Sydney Democracy Network, and from time to time I put my shoulder to the wheel of the network. I want to acknowledge that we meet on the lands of the Gadigal people. The Gadigal people, as you know, are one of around 29 clans of the Eora people. The Gadigal people have been living on these lands for some 40,000 years. The land remains theirs and shall forever. I want to say something briefly about, before opening officially this Festival of Democracy, our third annual festival, I want to say something briefly about SDN, the Sydney Democracy Network. We are about 2 years old. We are a network of, a mixed network of scholars, of actors out in the field, and of organizational people. Our network includes, although based here at the University of Sydney, it includes organizations on the outside, some academic, for example, in Berlin, the WZB, which is Europe's largest social science think tank, and also organizations locally, such as Greenpeace, and we have good working liaisons, I suppose we could put it, with organizations, networked organizations like WikiLeaks. We are trying very hard to have a multimedia presence. We have scholars who publish in various places, in the New York Times, Foreign Affairs, the one and only The Conversation. We have people who do lots of radio and television work. We have good working links, I would say, with the ABC, though not very good working links with the Australian. I think that most of the work we are doing, as you'll see from our website, is very digital, and we're trying, so to say, to build a network that mimics and draws life from digital networked media. We're a network that doesn't agree about democracy, but we are very well aware of its rather mixed history, and of course all of the things that have been said against democracy in the past, beginning with old Greeks such as Plato, for whom it was just mobocracy, the rule of the ignorant. We're aware of a history of skepticism and satire against its ideals. Think of the famous remark of the 19th century of Flaubert, that the whole problem with democracy and the dream is that it wants to raise the proletariat to the level of the stupid bourgeoisie. Or think of those who, in our times, are very critical of the way that the central nervous system of democracy, parties, periodic elections, parliaments, are just not functioning as they should be. And that all comes with a deep hostility in many places to politicians and parties and to parliaments and politics more generally. And you know that some opinion polls are disturbing. Young Australians, a majority it seems on one poll, are actually not that much interested in democracy and are prepared to think that there might be better ways of handling power. That disturbs us. We're aware of the deep challenges facing democracy. Practically every democracy is now a plutocracy. We're aware of the continuing problem of violence. We're aware of the growth of cross-border organizations. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is just one example. And we're aware of the rise of regimes, China, Russia, Iran, that seem to have democratic qualities that take us into a world beyond democracy, as many of us think of it and dream of it. I'd say that despite the disagreement, our network has something of a touch of Churchill about it. Not much is going well these days in democracy, but so far no better way of handling power has yet been invented. I want to thank the SDN team, who have worked for many, many months to draw together an amazing program, which, as you know, continues into tomorrow. Lindy Baker is here, who has been absolutely tireless. There will be more praise, Lindy, coming in the next day. Shui Ting, Janice, who I nickname our Wonder Woman, who has been working very long hours to draw all this together. Audrey Coe is somewhere here, so is Iona Rennie. Giovanni Navaria is here, Rachel Lee is here. Simon Torme is going to appear very soon. He's our line manager, who's a rather good manager, and doesn't much keep us in line. I don't think he's here yet, so I can get away with that. And thanks to the Yeoman Bedell, that wonderful post here at the University of Sydney in the quadrangle, Dennis, who has made helped us make these arrangements. I want to hand now to Felicity Ruby, the one and only Felicity Ruby, who is a doctoral candidate here at the University of Sydney, working with SDN, has promised in recent correspondence to combust spontaneously. And so on that note, and with the thought that democracy does mean lots of discussion, but it's only effective if you can stop people talking, I hand over to Felicity. Thank you very much for all that you've done.
Thank you, John. It's lovely to be here with you all tonight. This is apparently the oldest lecture theatre in the country, which I think is pretty special. It's also pretty special to be the opening discussion of the conference. And I wanted to notice also that the closing session of the conference is also on this issue of surveillance. What does it mean? How are we coping with it? What kinds of challenges, what kinds of fates do democracy and democracy projects, democracy movements have in the face of pervasive surveillance? We've gathered tonight some of the great experts in our country on this issue. So I'm really pleased that we can benefit from the wisdom of Frank Moorhouse, whose book, Australians Under Surveillance. You can see the cover up here. We haven't got any for sale here tonight, but I'd really encourage you to go out and buy it. It's two fantastic essays he wrote about the dark conundrum, as he described it, of how we balance security and privacy, and also another essay about the writer in the time of terror, and a very interesting interview he did with the, at the time, Director General of ASIO, David Irvine. It's a wonderful book, as are his books down underneath the trilogy, what's called the Edith Trilogy, in which a very wonderful character, Ambrose, is a spy of sorts. And this trilogy tells you and teaches so much about the League of Nations, the United Nations, and the growth of Canberra as we know it. And I really encourage you to read it. It's such a wonderful way to learn about history and to think about the ideas we're going to be discussing tonight. So Frank Moorhouse is with us, as is Bernard Keane, further along, who is the Crikey correspondent in Canberra, the politics editor of Crikey, and has been such a tireless reporter of a blow-by-blow, day-by-day account of what's actually happening with our policies in this country, what's happening to our rights, what kinds of surveillance we're under, what kinds of arguments are being given, and how they stand up to scrutiny. Bernard has just written his first novel. It's called Surveillance. It's up there with the big eye. It's a very racy novel. It's very much worth reading. I encourage you to buy it, and he'll talk about it tonight. And furthest away from me is Nicky Hager, who's come all the way from New Zealand. Nicky wrote a really groundbreaking book in 1996 called Secret Power, and it was the first book I read as I started my PhD, reread. But it's a wonderful book that really explained for the first time in a very comprehensive way the echelon spy system of the Five Eyes countries, the US, the UK, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand, the arrangements for mass surveillance. And his book was so powerful in its kind of aha moments that it provided the world that it helped to spark, along with the movement and others as well, of course, a year-long inquiry into Echelon in the European Parliament. And a very strong and solid report came out, and a resolution and debate happened in the European Parliament on what date? The 5th of September 2001. And it was really a very unfortunate moment for resolve on these issues to become, to sort of reach a crescendo, because we all know what happened a few days later, which changed the context very much for advancement on this issue. So, you know, the urgent relevance that we feel about this issue is partly informed, or more recently informed, by the Snowden revelations, of course. So I want to turn first to Nicky and ask him, what's, you broke in 1996, what mass surveillance apparatus, practices, routines, procedures were in place. Snowden has done similar. What's new about the Snowden revelations? What do we know for sure now that we didn't know then? And, you know, what do you think's changed about the debates that were happening in the early 2000s and now?
Good evening, everyone. Hello. Kia ora tato from New Zealand. To start with your final question, a lot of what's going on now is very similar to what happened in the 90s. Up to 2001, the growing world awareness of these systems, which hadn't even been there before, has reached a similar stage at the moment. And since we don't have a war on terror coming down the tracks right now, a new one, or a new September 11, we might see that story play out in a different way than it did that time. But can I tell you what's changed? When I wrote that book, what happened was that New Zealand is one of the Five Eyes members. For strange historic reasons, dating back to shortly after the Second World War, when Britain and the US formed their Cold War Intelligence Alliance, Britain asked to bring some of its old colonial territories into the alliance. And this was Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. And so our not hugely important in the world countries are a part of this tightest, most powerful intelligence alliance on Earth. And the results, probably the most important result of that from a New Zealand perspective for the world, is that I was able to interview a whole series of the people inside our junior intelligence agency in New Zealand, one of those Five Eyes Alliance agencies, and find out about how worldwide systems worked, which hadn't been revealed in other parts of the world. So I think our greatest contribution to world intelligence was the whistleblowers in New Zealand, which in that earlier round allowed these systems to be revealed. And what they showed was what you might call mass surveillance 1.5 or something, compared to the Snowden era 7.3 or whatever it would be. But what they showed was that surveillance had changed fundamentally from everyone's original ideas of what spying meant. Electronic spying until those decades had meant that you bugged the telephone or you targeted a particular person or you eavesdropped on an embassy. But what had changed was that with the advent of computers and with the technological opportunity that they provided, the US and its allies had moved to a system of trying to basically spy on the whole world. In those days, the bulk communications of the world were traveling by satellite, not then by undersea cable. And so the system was set up, this one called the Echelon system, which tried to tap all the major routes, the trunk lines of email and phone and telex around the world being carried by satellites, grab not just their target, their particular targets, but all the communications going through those links and processing them through computers. So that was the revelations that I found and put into that book there, and which helped to prompt those debates which happened in the late 1990s. So what's changed since then? The Echelon system is more or less the blueprint for what we have today. And that is that the basic underlying principle of the Snowden era is to try to get all the communications of the world. That's the principle that if you raid everything, if you collect in a mass way, then whatever subject you're interested in, you can then find out about by dipping into your databases of information. So that's the basic principle of the Snowden era is exactly the same. But the thing that's changed is that in the 20 years between when I was interviewing people in our spy agency and when Snowden was sitting in Hawaii saving documents off the server there to take away on his quest to reveal these things, What changed in that time was that the technological development meant that there are astronomically more ways to spy than there were then. At that time, the main communications of the world, as I said, were going by these links up to satellites in space and down again. Nowadays, the internet provides endless opportunities for surveillance. You can tap into the internet, but also every single defect or characteristic of a PC computer provides new ways of spying. Each part of the different social media of the world provide new ways of surveillance. In fact, every characteristic of the worldwide digitally based communications and storage and the way we live our lives digitally, each provides a new opportunity for surveillance. And so have these agencies changed? No. They've just continued to use every technical opportunity they can find to spy on the world. But the changes in technology have meant that they've got vastly more ways to do that. And that's what the Snowden revelation showed us, this huge, slightly hard to believe, fanatical effort to grab every kind of communication everywhere in the world, country by country. The final thing I would say is, sorry, this has been a long introduction, but just to set the scene, the final thing I'd say is that there's one other way that things haven't changed at all from when I started writing about this. And that is that the official reasons why what these organizations do has always been basically untrue. That if you've heard the replies to the Snowden revelations, what you will hear is a convenient and untruthful little story about how the reason why they need these systems is because of the threats of terrorism and because of the threats of cyber attacks. You probably have heard plenty of times before, which means the subtitle of that is China is after Australia. But that's not actually what these agencies do, mostly. That is a tiny part. The Snowden revelations, which I've been working my way through for New Zealand, so I've dug deep into them, show that terrorism is a minor, marginal part of what these agencies do. That cyber warfare, as they call it, or cyber espionage, as it actually is an interesting but side part of what these agencies do. And the main thing that they do, which they don't want to be discussed because it has such an obsessive and illegitimate ring to it, is that they still try to spy on every country on Earth. And so New Zealand is helping to spy on many of the countries of the Pacific and into Asia and other parts. Australia takes over from New Zealand between Solomon Islands and PNG and then spies on all the countries up through Southeast Asia and other parts of the world. And that's the secret that they don't want people to talk about because it's such a presumptuous, antisocial, disconnected from the rest of our foreign policies thing to be doing. So that's my brief, or not very brief, introduction to what we can now talk about. Thank you.
That's a good introduction and helps us understand a little bit about what's different now and then. Frank, what would you say is different? You've been writing and thinking about issues of censorship. You've noticed, you know, fluctuations, undulations in these debates. What do you think the impact of the Snowden revelations have been? Were you shocked by them?
Well, no, I'm very rarely shocked now. I wish I was back to the point in my life where I was shocked more often. One of the things that it brought home was, of course, that a very, very critical and fundamental new truth, if you like, which, of course, that Nicky brought home to us, is that the secrets of state the secrets even of our national security agencies are no longer safe, are sound and secure. But what it brought home, and what it also brought home was that, in fact, nor are we, that the citizens' secrets, the citizens' privacy, what was convention, I have a lot, the conventions of privacy, the assumptions of privacy, the assumptions of what the state needed to know and what it can know, were suddenly revealed. So there was a remarkable new piece of in the puzzle, if you like, that that the state can't be secure, is not secure in its information, and we aren't secure in ours. We don't know where it begins. In the citizen's case, we don't know where it begins and ends. I swore to God I wouldn't. I swore to God that I wouldn't quote. I thought I won't quote Orwell. I hope that there must be a moratorium on the quoting Orwell. And however, and he did make a statement which showed that he had the foresight or the anxiety. It may not have been a foresight so much as an anxiety. And I'll just read it out to you. And well, I'm sorry, here's some more Orwell. Best use the right glasses. There was, of course, no way of knowing whether you were being watched at any given moment. It was even conceivable that the thought police watched everybody all the time. They could plug in your wire whenever they wanted to. You had to live in the assumption that every movement was scrutinized. That was 1947. We have reached pretty much that situation. But as I said, so have governments. The other new key player or agent in the situation is the whistleblower. And this is and the hacker, the whole idea of hacking and whistleblowing and penetration by citizens. For various reasons and motives, have become a critical part of the oversight of national security agencies. There are a number of shining examples of this. We have I actually gave an address here at the university to postgraduates and graduates who were receiving their graduation certificates, and I was invited to give the address, and I talked about what at least was presented as a talk about professionalism, and because some of you were graduating into the professions, and I was able to point out to them that there is now a professional association for national security agencies, and they have a code of ethics which involves very similar to the code of ethics. They have a lawyer or a doctor. The recruits into national security agencies are now starting to see themselves as professionals in the sense that they are bound by the rules of evidence, the rules of basic fundamentals of law and the rule of law and civil liberties, and could very well be that there is in fact a new type of recruit into, and some of those I was talking to were probably going to be recruited into it. And part of my new thinking about security organisations is that we need the citizen in this maze of who knows who, and we all know more than we ever thought we'd know, and they are less secure. I pointed out that there had to be a new contract between the citizen and the national security agencies, and part of this would involve one of the planks. I have probably 10 planks which I won't reach the end of today, but one is that national security agencies such as ASIO, especially ASIO, have to begin to think of themselves as a think tank, as an independent body, highly trained, highly resourced, given quite unique powers in many cases to gather data, and that there has to be an evolution in their thinking to see themselves as serving reality as a organization that gathers evidence about the political reality of our nation, what are or are not threats, and to do basically analytical work which they then feed to policing agencies and the government of the day. And this movement into a different orientation, if you like, to their work will be one of the things that will save us, and the whistleblowing will become, should be built into their employment structure. By the way, the Federal Public Service has a whistleblowing structure within the organisation, and their whistleblowers are protected in some many ways, and but it doesn't apply to ASIO, and it perhaps should.
Yeah, good ideas there. Bernard, do you have any thoughts here about Snowden's revelations and Australia in particular? You know, the role that Australia plays in partnership with the NSA, but also the agencies that are domestic agencies like ASIO that Frank has spoken of. What have we learned about Australia from Snowden, and what is the feeling in Canberra where you're analysing these developments in surveillance policy?
I think the key, to use the political phrase, the key sort of takeout from what we've learnt so far about Australia's role in the Five Eyes network and the various tools they use is, and this picks up on exactly the point that Nicky made about the fact that we're told this is about national security, we're told this is about terrorism, but in fact, so much of it is actually commercially driven, economically driven. That's why Australian Signals Directorate was spying on Indonesian trade negotiators in relation to the you know, the crucial terrorism issues of prawn and tobacco imports into the United States, over which there was a dispute between Indonesia and the United States. And Australia, ASD, fed the information that they obtained from surveilling Indonesian trade negotiators to the Americans. And that's just one small example of the fact that so much of what we do, and of course we're spending vast amounts of money, albeit a fraction of what the United States and Great Britain are spending, but so much of what we do is actually economic and commercial in nature. And I use both of those words deliberately, economic and commercial, because there was a brief debate in Australia when it was revealed that ASD was involved in this sort of surveillance about the fact that Australian agencies engage in economic espionage, because it's written into their acts. I mean, it's written into the intelligence, the foundation acts of our intelligence agencies, that they can engage in espionage activities, information collecting activities in relation to Australia's national interests, which includes economic interests. But if you dare to use the word commercial, you got a very, very angry reaction from the government, because their insistence was, this is not about benefiting individual Australian companies. This is about Australia's national interest. And that's a completely spurious distinction. You know, it's a distinction without a difference, because ultimately this is for Australia's and the Five Eyes' economic interests, I think, far more than terrorism. And Nicky made the point very, very well that the terrorism, you know, is actually in reality a relatively limited part of their activities. And that sort of very brief debate about commercial versus economic espionage was, I think, that was as good as the debate got in Australia that in response to the Snowden revelations. I mean, in Australia there has been no debate, virtually no debate whatsoever, about either the implications for Australians of mass surveillance programs in general, or the specific activities of Australian agencies cooperating with the Five Eyes espionage activities and signals gathering.
Why not?
That's a really good question. I generally do not understand why not. I suspect it's linked to the reasons why the data retention debate here in Australia was a bit of a fizzer, and that this legislation was able to be got up with very little kind of response or reaction from the broader community. In contrast to the United States, for example, where, you know, there's been a big debate, there has been, you know, Obama was forced to commission, well, forced, but Obama commissioned a review, which turned out to be, you know, somewhat embarrassing. in identifying that, in fact, mass surveillance was not particularly useful for stopping terrorist attacks. There's been some tweaks, significant tweaks, to the legal framework within which US agencies operate. You know, compared to Australia, I mean, the Americans have had a full, free and frank debate about revelations, and you know, there have even been Republicans and Democrats who've been happy to call Edward Snowden a whistleblower. Here, Edward Snowden is officially a traitor. It doesn't matter whether it's Mark Dreyfus saying that or George Brandis saying that, and there has been no debate whatsoever. And any attempts to initiate debate are shut down with the response that that's an operational matter, we don't discuss operational matters. And the media lets them get away with it. And this is my great frustration with Australia's mainstream media, is that we don't have a media that is sufficiently aggressive on this issue of, well, actually, no, that's not a reason to shut down debate about what our signals intelligence gathering arm is doing spying on Indonesian trade negotiators or spying on the inner circle of President Yudhoyono, or the fact that we know that ASIS, our foreign intelligence agency, bugged the East Timorese cabinet. They broke the law. It's open and shut. They broke the law. They broke ACT law in doing that. Good old ACT. They broke the ACT law, and yet the issue lies completely fallow, except for the fact that the former ASIS agent who revealed that and his lawyer are under investigation. So, as part of, you know, we've got our own sort of local version of Barack Obama's ongoing war on whistleblowers here in Australia. So, you know, the chilling thing about all the Snowden revelations from an Australian perspective is not just finding out A, what is being done around the world, B, what role we are playing in it, but C, that our policymakers can get away with pretending that it just doesn't exist and that there is no need to actually discuss any of this.
Do you want to respond to that, Nicky?
No, move on.
Okay, we'll move on. Okay. So I wanted to turn to the subject matter of the panel, which is about facts and fiction. So I think Snowden has helped to concretize and prove as facts things that we thought might be true, or somebody said was true, but we didn't have documents. So I think that's another distinguishing feature of what Snowden has given us, which is confirmation and raw materials. You know, these terrible PowerPoint slides that are somewhat embarrassing for these very multi-billion dollar agencies. You'd think that they could put better PowerPoint presentation together. But the facts and fictions issue is interesting too, because two of our panelists have written both fiction and non-fiction about this issue. And I wanted to ask you, Frank, you've been under surveillance, you know, since you were 17 by ASIO. When you got your file, you found out that you've been under surveillance. All those years of being a fiction writer and a non-fiction writer and an activist here on this campus and all over the country, but very much in this area. And you've done serious interrogations of the intellectual political quandaries that surveillance and poses to us. And in fiction, you've brought us these characters that we've come to love, like Ambrose, you know, who was a spook. So what is it that fiction can do, and what are its effects, and what is rendered differently when you write fiction and non-fiction, and how have people responded to your work in these two, using these two forms?
Well, of course, here I am mentioning Orwell again. Of course, when Orwell wrote that, he was writing fiction. And the fiction has now become the reality. When I was interviewing the Director General of ASIO, I thought that given that he'd been looking at me since I was 17 and compiling a file, they never found that I was a danger to the state. And I was, though if they had made a mistake, and I was a cadet journalist and then a journalist with the ABC, and I remember being called into the news editor's office at the ABC as a 28-year-old journalist, and he said that I was to cover a very important military exercise involving the United States and the UK and New Zealand and Australia and other countries in the South Seas. and the Coral Sea, in the Coral Sea. And he said, ASIO has cleared you. And I thought, my God, ASIO, there's the chief of staff on our newspaper who decides what journalist does what, and the news editor is part of that process. And of course, then ASIO decides who's the chief of staff, is the final chief of staff, and decides whether you're going to be allowed to cover the story. And I got that report. Eventually, by the way, every citizen can go on and demand their ASIO file. There's a 20-year rule, that is, that it's you won't get the last 20 years, but everything before that. That's how I discovered that I'd been actually being covered. If in fact they'd got it wrong and ASIO had said, yes, he is a danger to the state, they didn't know I was an active member of the anarchist group in Balmain. There were four of us, I think five. But we planned things. We actually, if they'd come across some of our plans, I might have ended up in jail instead of being a reporter. So if they'd got that wrong, I would not. My journalistic career may have well been over at the ABC and maybe elsewhere. However, talking to the Director General, I was. They had to give it a lot of thought before they allowed me to come and talk to him and interview him. But in that, I said to him, why aren't you making, involving yourself in the making of television programs like there were programs about the Commonwealth, about the border protection. In most countries are now making TV series about that. There are all sorts of other sorts of programs, and of course many, many films about spy agencies and so on, fiction films. And the fiction has a role to play in setting up scenarios that this could possibly be the way it is. And often, and the best of these films draw on ex-CIA or ex-FBI or ex-MI5 and so on, that they have some expert data coming in, and the fiction is in part sound research based, and the usefulness of this is that it both sets up scenarios that make us think about what these agencies can do and not do. Of course, one of the most successful films is The Lives of Others. Have people seen The Lives of Others? Yeah. I don't know about Argo, the film where the CIA smuggled out its American embassy. American embassy staff by pretending to make a film. They said it was based on facts, but they left New Zealand. They gave New Zealand a bum rap in it. New Zealand was a very big player. The New Zealand embassy in Iraq, this was in Iran, and was a big player. But they dropped New Zealand out for punishing you for not allowing nuclear ships into your harbours. So there is it's a very strange relationship. It deals with, which I'd love to go on and talk about, is what the actual nature and authority of the imagination is. The imagination is just not waffle or daydreaming. It's often an informed part of the intelligence and a very special kind of use of the intelligence, and has great capacities to foresee. And it has capacities to hit on truths and to ferret out truths. And I did my trilogy, which Grandet's Dark Palace and Cold Light are three novels which have as their background the development of international diplomacy. They begin at the League of Nations in 1926 in Geneva. And they were heavily researched. I spent 5 years on each of those books, and often and mostly working with files in Geneva and the Library of Congress and so on. So the very best fiction writers you have to remember are also working with fact and using the remarkable capacities to foresee and to create, if you like, train the citizenship in what might happen or what is happening with secret agencies.
Wonderful. Bernard, you've said similar things in terms of your novel Surveillance being somewhat based on things, every part has been based on something that has happened or very close to something that's happened. So how are you freed up in fiction to tell stories that you're trying to tell in non-fiction almost every day? You expressed real frustration before in the way that the media is handling this issue. Was some of that frustration informing why you wrote a fiction account to try and get through?
It was, what I've tried to do in Surveillance is repurpose a lot of things that have already happened into a narrative that has less distractions and less sort of clutter to kind of draw out the kind of themes that I want to draw out. What I ended up doing was there's not a whole lot of imagination in it because it doesn't actually need a whole lot of dramatisation. What goes on in the world of cybersecurity doesn't need much in the way of dramatisation because it's so astonishing and absurd. I mean, there's a small bit in the book where one of the company has a multi-$100 million contract with the Pentagon to provide a kind of a combat version of Google Glass, and they can't do it, so they get a game company to invent footage, which they then give to the Pentagon, to suggest they've actually done it. And between writing that and later, I kind of forgot that I had lifted that almost detail for detail from an incident involving the company SAIC, an enormous conglomerate in the United States, and it's a very, very busy company here in Australia as well. So, I didn't actually need to kind of gild the lily. It was all this sort of stuff is there. It's a question of rearranging it so that you can tease out the sort of themes that you want to tease out. And what I was very keen to do was to do something which is quite hard, in non-fiction, which is to kind of connect up different forms of surveillance. So I wanted to make the point that surveillance is actually a spectrum that runs from the electronic through to, it's not just about cybersecurity and hacking. It's about the kind of urban environment that we live in now, where it's almost impossible to live without leaving some sort of digital trail or trail about your personal information, through to the interpersonal, and then you get into the role of gender, because surveillance is about power, and I was very keen to kind of explore the issue of the gendered nature of surveillance, of some forms of surveillance. So it's very hard to kind of do that in a non-fiction setting, because you're very tied down to trying to explore one particular aspect of an issue, whereas fiction allows you to kind of connect them up and then hopefully encourage the reader to make those connections without being too didactic ultimately you want to write an entertainment, but it does have a didactic dimension. You've kind of got to cloak that dimension in some subtlety. But yeah, you can remove the clutter a bit and kind of lead the readers to start linking together things that maybe they wouldn't have otherwise thought about. I mean, I wrote a piece back in, 2012 for Crikey about the whole issue of gender and surveillance. But I'd much rather read an entertainment that draws that out rather than, a 1,000 word piece that kind of just hammers the reader with, bang, 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 bang. So it's about fiction and non-fiction are tools for achieving what you want to achieve, and they have different strengths.
Nicky, I wonder, you haven't written fiction. Have you ever considered it? And do you consume fiction in this field? And do you think that, as you've talked about this issue for so long, how do you feel that sort of fictional accounts of spooking, the glamorisation of spooking, the James Bond genres, how has that affected how people think about these issues? Do you think that it's affected things in that way?
My sister's a novelist. Mm-hmm. I write non-fiction, and then talking I've realised what the other speakers have said, which is that writing fiction and non-fiction is a very similar process of gathering material and telling stories and things. So I think they're not very different, and they can be done for all sorts of good and bad purposes. The thing which I would like to raise about the fictionalisation of surveillance is things like the film Enemy of the State. Now, if you haven't seen it, this is a film which presents the idea that if they want to, they can see you walking down the street, they can shift from CCTV camera to CCTV camera, everyone's being watched all the time, it's all over, it's already happened. Which I find very disturbing, because it's actually the same message which people have been getting from the Snowden papers, erroneously to some extent. And I think we should care about this a great deal, because it's kind of sexy, and man, it gets attention, and it gets attention when you talk about surveillance and say that everyone's being spied on all the time. But these are people's lives. These are people who everywhere, people are hearing this, and it's actually deeply affecting their lives, I fear. I run into the journalists who are scared to meet their sources, but I also meet so many normal people who have had their sense of self and privacy and their space around them to be themselves altered by their sense that they're being watched all the time. And the point about that I want to make is that this is not correct, that this is the fearful end point of these things, but the Snowden documents don't show that everyone is being spied on all the time. They actually don't show that. They show that there's this madcap plan to try to have the capability to spy on everything so that when they want to find the particular, they can get it. But that doesn't mean that everyone's being spied on all the time. And so I'm turning the question here to something which I really feel needs to be spoken about strongly in the current surveillance debates, which is that us who care about the implications of surveillance and spying on other countries and inequalities of power and the privacy issues that are raised by it, don't become the people who also scare and change the lives of other people needlessly by overstating what's going on. So fiction has done it, but us people who are involved in non-fiction have to make sure that we don't do it as well.
It's a very disempowering message, isn't it, that people can take. And this is exactly my concern about the Snowden revelations is I think a lot of people's reaction to it was, well, what can you do?
Give up.
And yeah, exactly, give up. And that is a deeply damaging and disheartening kind of response, because you just disempower yourself. You decide that there's not a whole lot you can do. There is this vast entity out there, a monolith that is, you know, almost omnipotent and omniscient. And you have no choice about how you respond to that. And that's actually, there are choices about how you respond to that politically and in terms of what you personally do. But I think there is a sense of, particularly if you don't know the detail of the Snowden documents, to kind of think, well, you know, there is a global surveillance network and there's no escaping it and it's already in existence and, you know, I'll just get on with my life. You're so overwhelmed by it that you don't engage with it, I think.
I'll just get on with my life, but maybe I won't get involved in politics because it might hurt my
career
one day.
Exactly, because you have a chilling effect.
And yeah. All the rest.
I have a whole chapter in the book in Unders about on nihilism, the political position of which is the world is screwed and we can't do anything about it. And in fact, at present, in terms, say, of the Middle East, diplomatically, militarily, and in terms of national security, most of the Western countries are totally baffled. That is, we do not know what to do. And the citizen, when faced with, well, what we got, did I say? I believe in count seven national security bodies within Australia. We do not know what to do. And the only thing that saves us is having glimpses provided by Snowden, glimpses provided by whistleblowers, glimpses provided by fantastically diligent and penetrating and cunning journalists, and Bernard and others come into this, and Nicky, that in fact there is a good reason to be nihilistic. The other great area where we are at sea, if you like, is of course the internet, and the internet is a a strange beast where we didn't vote to have it, and we are trying to control it, but we don't know where it begins and ends. Bernard mentioned the commercial aspects of it, of what's sometimes called big data, which is being mined by commercial companies. And of course, we don't know, again, they don't know what they're looking for often. They don't know what they're likely to find. And we don't know who owns that material, and we don't know who controls it. Yesterday, I learned, where the internet is running a computer is baffling, but our Prime Minister revealed that said that there's a wonderful new app called Slack. Slack is a new app. And I thought, that's an app for me. Slack is certainly an app for me on bad days. And he said, this is I'm not pretending to know the full extent of Slack, but it means that groups of people can get together and converse and in an encrypted way, work up projects in real time, and it forms an archive. It's accessible. But the other thing he didn't quite reveal, and it's kept in the cloud, and he didn't realize that in fact what one of the things that Slack does is it bypasses the new legislation that we've just introduced about data retention and data surveillance of the internet traffic, which we've just this because we don't know where it's located. It could be located in Bulgaria. The storage facility could be in Bulgaria. It could be in Brazil, and it's outside. It's not under any sovereign jurisdiction. And so we've got a number of. We have the internet. We have the strange growth of religious violence and religious war, which of course goes back hundreds of years, and the Christians have fought it, and the Catholics and the Protestants fought it for 30 years in Ireland. We are baffled by at least three major parts of our current reality, and I think on some days we're all nihilists. Some days we say the place is screwed and we can't do anything about it. Three of us here have written books about it. That's something we did about it.
It's very... On different days I feel more or less sort of overwhelmed by what we find out. And when there's another Snowden revelation, you know, there's a tendency to kind of... You know, that kind of sense of feeling overwhelmed and not having any options... can be stronger. But just on the issue of Slack, I mean, the fact that we have a Prime Minister, ex-communications minister, one of whose ways of selling data retention was to try and tell you that there are ways to get around it. but then he's then revealed to actually be using his own personal server, Hillary Clinton style, although he insists that there's nothing classified on it. I mean, that's just one example. It might be a trivial example. It's not trivial for the Australian Signals Directorate. They're the people who are responsible for vetting every application and platform and piece of equipment that our parliamentarians use to make sure they can't be easily hacked by the Chinese. So I imagine ASD had an absolute fit when they discovered Malcolm Turnbull was using his own private server. But it's a small example of the, you know, something that annoys the hell out of me, which is the asymmetry of information in all this. Governments want to know everything about us, but they want us to know less and less about them. And under this government in particular, since 2013, you know, there's been an absolutely systematic war on transparency. I mean, freedom, public servants now routinely talk about, you know, trying to avoid freedom of information. and how they want freedom of information to be rolled back, because it's too, you can't advise a minister properly if someone's going to find out what you advise the minister, which begs the question of, well, what are you so worried about if you're worried that people are actually looking at what your advice to a minister is? And I've been a public servant for a long period of time, so I know exactly the kind of thinking that goes on within the public service about freedom of information. But we're seeing, whether it's Operation Sovereign Borders or the reactions to the East Timorese bugging revelations or the response to Snowden revelations, transparency is rolling back in Australia, and there is this, you know, the asymmetry is getting worse and worse. Governments know more and more about us, we know less and less about what they're doing, the veil of secrecy is falling over more and more areas. We've got an immigration department that is basically a paramilitary outfit that insists that national security considerations mean that we can't know what's going on in the kind of what I call the open air rape camp that we operate on Nauru, and we do operate it, not the Nauruans. So there's a war on transparency, which is exactly at odds with the kind of war on privacy that the government is actually engaged in. So Malcolm Turnbull and his private email server, you know, good on him. But it just demonstrates the kind of profound hypocrisy that is at the heart of mass surveillance between governments who are absolutely hate the idea, reinforced by the actions of Chelsea Manning, the actions of Edward Snowden, absolutely hate the idea of any transparency or scrutiny that they don't control, versus what they want, which is complete control over how much they scrutinise us.
I'm having an optimistic day today. I think we're as likely to win the war against knowing about government as they are to know about us, I think, with whistleblowers and all sorts of other sorts of freedom of information, transparency, and other ideas which are not dead and have a great life in them, can be reinforced through the current democratic system. And that's where we've got to fight.
Yeah, so I mean, we've gone from some pretty intense nihilism here and some pessimism, and I want to get to what is to be done, what are the kinds of changes we need to see. Nicky, you know, at the 2-year point of Snowden's revelations, he came out with a statement that was very positive. He felt that there was new spirit to the debate, that there had been challenges and that there was courage being demonstrated and that people were waking up. He really was quite hopeful. Every now and then, Julian Assange is also quite hopeful. How are you hopeful? When are you hopeful? People are demonstrating. They're getting out and in front of these installations. They're exposing. They're standing up. People are protesting. Are we going to see more of that? Is there going to be progress in this debate?
Well, first of all, let me admit to a personality defect. I'm endlessly hopeful, so I'm maybe the wrong person to ask on that. But let me put it in a framework. I think that to look at this issue, what we need to realise is that we're in a very unusual moment at the moment with Snowden revelations. This normal and preferred state of affairs about security and intelligence issues is that no one talks about it, no one knows, there's no information, there's no debate, there's a great silence. And the way that these organisations are able to perpetuate themselves down through the decades, running foreign policies which many of their citizens, or often most of their citizens, don't even agree with, is because of that silence. That in the middle of revelation after revelation from Snowden, we could fool ourselves to think that this is just a normal thing, that there's always this stuff raining from the skies revealing the deepest secrets of the intelligence agencies, but this doesn't usually happen. And the normal thing is a silence. And so what does this make me think? The first one is that we should not take the opportunity that we have at the moment for granted. That this is he has done a great favour to the world, and this is the time to debate these things, not to feel like we can take our time. This doesn't come around all the time. This is an unusual occasion that he's provided us, an exceptional occasion.
Yes, I think one great part of oversight apparatus which works, but is also seriously flawed. But one part of the oversight apparatus is the public servant who leaks, and the leaking is is as important as the Freedom of Information Act. But I just wanted to make if we're going to have a new one of the things we should be fighting for is, of course, there is an Office of Inspector General of Security and Intelligence. This is the office which is supposed to be the oversight body in our current structure. And this body, the ASIO, I think, has a staff of 800 now.
1,800. She's got 13.
I was using yesterday's figures. And growing, recruiting and advertising. But the Inspector General has a staff of 12. And we have to have a massively stronger and a more canny and more relentless and vigilant Office of Inspector General, and that has to be totally beefed up if we've got any chance whatsoever.
Well, I mean, on oversight, I mean, Inspector General of Intelligence and Security, well, yeah, it's a tiny office. It depends on the characteristic of the actual inspector. I don't think Vivian Tom was worth tuppence as a watchdog on our intelligence community, and her response to the East Timorese issue, I think, demonstrated that. A debate that needs to happen in Australia, and Labor, to its credit, has made some effort to do it, is if we're going to constantly expand the powers of our intelligence agencies, which is what we've been doing since 2001, and we've been doing it relentlessly for the last 13, 15 months, we need to dramatically overhaul the framework for the oversight of our intelligence agencies. At the moment, we have a intelligence committee, a joint intelligence committee made up of major party politicians, which has very limited powers. They can't even initiate their own inquiry. So if some major scandal broke out in ASIO, this committee can't actually off its own bat go and investigate. They need George Brandis to write to them and say, hey, would you like to inquire into this?
They have the power to be briefed, basically.
Yeah. So, I mean, what's been happening under because of Labor members of the committee is they have been pushing, to their credit, they've been pushing the remit of this committee to expand it, to give it much greater review powers over the tranches, to use George Brandis's word and pronunciation, tranches of national security legislation. Every time those tranches have gone through, the committee has sought to expand its remit. It still can't initiate its own inquiry. John Faulkner, whose departure from the Senate was a big loss in terms of national security oversight, left behind a bill that would overhaul the committee, expand its membership, so that you no longer had... There's all these rules about who can be on the committee, which basically mean that you get a deal between the major parties as to who's going to be on there. There's got to be, like, people with a balance between the Senate and the House. It would free up the personnel of the committee, and it would dramatically overhaul their role so that they could initiate whatever inquiries they wanted to. And in the right hands, that potentially, I think, would be a significant addition to the oversight that we need, because Australia is really... I don't know what the situation in New Zealand is. I'd be interested to hear from you, Nicky, on this, but our oversight, parliamentary oversight arrangements for intelligence agencies in Australia are rubbish compared especially to the Americans. The Americans actually have a pretty good congressional oversight system. The House committee might be run by fascists, but nonetheless they have significant power in terms of their capacity to oversight agencies like the CIA. That's why the Senate committee in the US conducts a whole report for years and years into torture by the CIA. The CIA spies on the committee to find out what's going on because they're so worried about the report. There is this epic tussle between the committee and the CIA over the release of the report. The CIA eventually has got to say, uncle, apologise for spying on them, and a major report is released. There is no possible way that can happen in Australia because we don't have an independent committee. The committee is always controlled by someone from the government. We've currently got a committee chair, Dan Tehan, who's an ambitious backbencher. He'd love to be a minister. Do you think he's really going to rock the boat in terms of that committee's activities? You need a committee that's properly separated from the executive, which is hard under the Australian system compared to the US system, I know. But there is some value in parliamentary oversight. And it sounds boring and it sounds unsexy to say, well, maybe some politicians sitting in committee, often in secret committee because they're dealing with national security matters, is a way of corralling our intelligence agencies. But in fact, if you want to be realistic, that's actually one of the tools that are available, and I think that we really need to work on expanding that. At the moment it's stymied, but I don't know, fingers crossed, maybe if Labor gets back into power at some point, they might actually revisit that John Faulkner bill and try and overhaul the committee.
Wishful thinking. I just want to join with Bernard about that joint committee. One of the most revealing things about that joint committee is to see the type of the first draft of legislation that comes to it, advised by ASIO and other security agencies and by the Attorney General. And the first draft of anything, any new legislation that comes with that is usually a horror show of authoritarianism. And the Joint Committee has modified the last three occasions that I looked at, that they are able to modify, they are able to bring in outside evidence or outside witnesses, and they are ultimately not only the Labor side, but also the Liberal, that they are a committee that can think and analyse and does break down and improve the legislation. Ultimately, the legislation can still contain within it frightening things, but the really frightening document is the first draft.
Nicky, one last hopeful thing, and then we'll throw it open to a few questions.
I would hate us to finish our discussion on the point of hoping for good things from parliamentary committees. And so I would like to say, even though I fully believe that it's worthwhile to try to have better oversight, and Inspector Generals do help to keep the agencies more legal, sticking to the law than they would otherwise be, that is not around the world where big progress comes from on surveillance issues. The place where it comes from, the main form of accountability and democratic progress that we have with agencies comes from leaks and scandals. This is the repeated story all around the world. You have the most secret agencies on earth, and the only way that they get susceptible for change is by leaks and the following scandals, where they're forced to be more legal and the public gets involved. So while I said that it's an unusual event to have something like the Snowden revelations, what I'm really arguing is that the most hopeful way that we will reform and get progress with these agencies is by having more Snowdens. And that's actually not a hopeless prospect, because what we've seen in recent years is sort of we've seen the WikiLeaks model, and this was Julian Assange's brilliance, I would like to say, and to his great credit, was the idea that in an era of increasing state power and increasing state secrecy, there needed to be some balancing power, and that was that leaking in the digital age had a huge power in return. And we've seen that through the huge leaks that happened with Chelsea Manning about the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. I think that if one day Snowden will quite likely say that those examples are part of what crystallized in his mind what he could do. And I feel very confident that ideas are more powerful than anything else, and there are other Chelseas and Edwards around the world making their plans right now.
Well, one's just come out today, and we have a whole new tranche of information about drone attacks. Okay, a couple of questions from the audience before we change panels.
There was a couple of points that came up while you were speaking, and one was that given the surveillance is basically data surveillance now, that it's all about data, and the flow of data is firstly a part of a privatization on the internet, and also transnational, then do we now simply just consider the effect of the nation state in with these issues, and we go beyond this? I mean, we were talking about issues related to state governments, that kind of thing, but maybe we need to consider farther afield, the issues of the farther afield, basically global data balance and privatization of networks.
Was there another hand down here? Yes.
I guess spying or surveillance is part of statecraft from time immemorial. But I like to believe in utopia, and I guess surveillance is always about something which could destabilize the system. But my question is, like, is it possible to use a surveillance to look for, things like, like there's a place, the Ebola virus is about to strike on a few million people who don't have food, So probably, like, that's the kind of, positive surveillance I'm talking about. Can it happen or does it could happen?
Are there any other questions that we can, yep.
I have a very similar question because it sounds like all surveillance is bad. Do you think there's bad and good surveillance? I was, for example, thinking of the, how quickly people called the Boston bomber. I was really impressed by the technology where it led to, and just wondering about your opinions.
Okay. All right, good. And there's one more down here?
Yep,
great.
I just wanted to respond to the conversation about the extent of the public imagination has been captured by the sense that we're all watched all the time. I think that what the public perceives is it's not just the spy agencies who are watching us. The police are watching us. They have the capability now with cell phone towers and with all the CCTV cameras that are out in our streets and in our malls. But also the big data, the companies like Facebook and TripAdvisor or any of those, the social media and the websites that we use that are going through our digital information and connecting it and selling it on to who knows who. So our sense of privacy in this digitalized era, I think, is disappeared. Mm-hmm. And it's very hard to evade. So it's not just about the spy agencies, I think. Mm-hmm. It's about this new world order that we're in now, which is, so it's different from what we all imagined that it was the thought police was watching you. But in fact, there are agencies that are beyond the state control.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we've got one more, shall we? So we've had so far privatisation, positive surveillance, police and privacy. So can your question please have a word with P in it?
Press.
Okay, great.
It's precisely because we have three journalists on the panel, and the thing that distresses me about this country, and I was really keen to hear from journalists what their thoughts are, their deep thoughts, is that so all the processes that you're describing, and I thoroughly recommend the documentary I've been watching called The United States of Secrets, in all of these leaks, right, there is someone to leak it to. And you describe the process on these with the Intelligence Committee. And what, I'm sorry, not being Australian, I'm a little bit distressed about the absence of a possibility of reception, right? So all of these whistleblowers, they go through the process, who do I report it to? Do I report it to the House Intelligence Committee in the United States? And then they all talk about the fourth rail, right? What are the chances of the fourth rail in this country? And how can this happen? And I say this in a context where we know that the availability of the internet should make that possible. So what is it that's not sort of taking off in terms of the possibility of a robust press that can stand up and be the fourth rail that enables surveillance to happen?
So I might ask the panelists to pick and choose from the questions they'd like to answer, but I'll try and make sure that they're all covered. Do you want to start, Nicky, and we'll come back this way? Or
can I please not start?
I'll start.
Okay, Bernard, please.
I've got answers for all those questions, actually, but I'll try and minimise it. Just on that last question, I think Australia has a very shallow pool when it comes to both the civil society institutions that we have that can address issues like surveillance. So we don't have any sort of equivalent to the ACLU or the EFF that actually had a large enough and had the resources to really, pursue a court case. Secondary problem, we don't have a constitution that allows those sort of court cases that you see in the United States. So we have a civil society sort of pool that's very shallow, and we have a media pool that's very shallow as well. And the quality of national security journalism in Australia, especially in recent years, has not been good. If I was a potential whistleblower, I would not be filled with confidence either about the national security journalists I could go to, or the safety that I could do that in, particularly now that we have a data retention regime which makes it far easier for our federal police to track down whistleblowers, and we know that our AFP are repeatedly asked by our public servants to go and track down whistleblowers who have revealed embarrassing information. So we're making it harder and harder for whistleblowers. I used to be completely negative on Australian national security journalists. I still am pretty negative, but you know, occasionally, even the bad ones do produce good material. But as I said, if I was a potential whistleblower, you know, I wouldn't be full of confidence about picking out someone to go and approach, you know, as per, you know, Snowden approaching Glenn Greenwald. So that's a kind of a rather depressing indictment of Australia. But it reflects the quality of our media at the moment. Our media is shrinking. It's under more and more pressure from the internet. Its revenues are down. The fewer and fewer journalists are covering more and more stuff. And that's playing out in national security as it's playing out in every other kind of round. Just on a question about is there good surveillance? Well, there's good surveillance if they get a warrant,
yeah.
And it's targeted at people that the police have a reasonable suspicion, objectively tested, that are doing something wrong. I want our police and our intelligence agencies to be able to do their job as much as anyone, but I don't think they actually can do it very well by engaging in mass surveillance. There's evidence that mass surveillance actually is unhelpful. You know, the Danish police complained about their data retention regime, which includes web history, by the way. They complained they had too much information. You know, there was just so much information to trawl through that they struggled. So, you know, I'm not convinced that mass surveillance is actually a particularly good tool. Targeted surveillance, go for your life. If you've convinced a judge that someone is engaged in no good, I want you to be able to surveil them. So I don't have a problem with that. But it's about the process. And I don't understand for the life of me why we can't have, if we're going to have a data retention regime, why can't you have a requirement that they get a warrant? What's the problem with that? The AFP said it would cost them $25 million a year to do that. They said $25 million a year as though to kind of scare people off. The AFP has a budget of about $1 billion a year. 25 million bucks more, it's nothing. In order to put in place, you know, a core requirement like getting a warrant. What's wrong with that?
Frank, do you want to pick up on any of those?
Don't get me started.
Okay.
There is again a chapter in the book where I look at the changing nature of our attitudes towards privacy. That the Law Reform Commission 5 years ago or so on brought out, I don't know, three-volume work, 2,900 pages on after investigating for 4 years. The concept of privacy, attitudes to privacy, what is private, what we used to consider to be private, and what isn't private anymore, the role, and of course that we yet fundamentally we feel that there are some things that should be private, but sadly, of course, a lot of privacy legislation, it's better that a lot of privacy legislation also reinforces stigmas if it's considered to be a breach of privacy to reveal that someone is gay or that someone is taking antidepressants. If that is considered to be a breach of privacy, then and a legal offence, then what the law is saying that these are in fact bad things. That should lower someone in the esteem of their fellow citizens. So there, it's a very complicated and the law reform three-volume work, which I don't believe anyone's read, has, and most of that wasn't accepted by the government. So the government couldn't agree. I think it's a very slippery term. I don't think we know what we're talking about. I think it's probably best dealt with as it has been for ages. Century by little pacts and little negotiations among the citizens themselves, like that's none of your business, don't tell anyone else about this. This is just between you and me. We have a hundred little negotiations go on daily about how we work with our privacy. Once it gets into the legal system, it'll be a mess. It's vaguely related to privacy, but it's something that another thing to worry about. This is like Radio National. If you listen to Radio National, it's just a list of things that any decent person should worry about and get very disturbed about. It can oppress you. I'll oppress you a little further about privacy and ASIO. And it's ASIO's relationship to the National Archives. The National Archives are, of course, the national memory and contains virtually everyone's name in one document or another. The current director of the National Archive was a former assistant director of ASIO. The director general of ASIO sits on the council of the National Archive. And behind all this, either ex-ASIO people or current ASIO people, there are teams that decide what files should be kept, what files should be released to the public, and on grounds of, quote, national security and other grounds as well. So there is a stranglehold, in a way, on the national memory exercised by ASIO. ASIO itself does not have to release its records as every other government department does and should, but the ASIO can also interfere with the release of documents from other government departments into the National Archive. So we've got a situation there that needs, I think, quite critical attention and urgent attention.
Nicky, last words before we have our next speaker.
Can I just pick up a few of the points which have been
raised?
First one is, I think it was a very important point about imagining the future whistleblower who's wondering where to go in the media. But this is a question which has got a solution, and that is that internet freedom and civil liberties people should be providing a service for that person. There should be somewhere where that person can go. This is actually a manageable task, provide information, lists, suggestions for the person who's in that position. That's something that should be happening in Australia, it should be happening in my country. Second thing I want to say is about the difference between good spying or justified spying and unjustified spying. Australia's got two separate, we haven't talked about it, it's got two separate surveillance systems. There's an internal system which is based on targeted surveillance. That's where the internet companies and telcos and so on are required to have the ability for the police and the intelligence agencies to dip in on a one-off targeted, warranted surveillance, which is what you need for criminals. It's also what you need for terrorists and that unlikely event and so on, which is completely separate from the systems which try and spy on the rest of the world in a huge mass and indiscriminate way. You can have one system without the other and still look after the legitimate tasks. The final thing I want to say is the thing that was raised about that this is about private companies, it's about an intrusion into all different parts of people's lives. And I don't think we should be too pessimistic on this. There's never been an internet before. The digital age, as it marches, all the changes it's bringing to society, has never happened before. There are all kinds of inevitable changes. But what always happens with new technology is that the technology brings the changes which we can't foresee and which just sweep across us, and then people think about them and they learn about it and they adapt. And we haven't had very much time to do that yet. People are just learning how to regain their privacy in social media. We're learning how to live our lives in the digital age. And that doesn't mean it's hopeless. It just means that in a lot of ways, it takes time for societies and individuals to catch up with the technological changes that are happening, but then you can do it. It's not the end of history, it's the beginning of the next phase where we have to deal with these things.
Please join me in thanking these wonderful panelists. Friday afternoon. There is a roaring crowd out there waiting to get in, so I think we're going to swiftly exit stage left.